Hello everyone and welcome to the next in this interview series. This time we're joined by Dr. Emily Dramet-Maunder, the Senior Manager for Public Astronomy here at the Royal Observatory Greenwich. Hello Emily.
Hi, nice to be here today.
Thank you for being here. So, what is it that made you get interested in astronomy in the first place?
So from a very young age, I always really liked to ask questions. And so I think that's why I was interested in science to begin with. But I think in astronomy, it's a field that lets you ask really big questions. So, you know, how we came to be here, or is there anything out there? You know, are there people like us on a different planet, kind of looking out at their own night sky, wondering, you know, if they're alone? And so, that's really why I got into astronomy, and just because it allowed me to ask those big questions and then try to answer them.
Mm. You grew up in a particularly rural place as well. So you grew up in
Indiana. Yeah.
In the United States of America.
Yes.
So did being able to see so many stars in the night sky really help in that regard?
Absolutely. Yes. So I grew up in southern Indiana, in the U.S. And it's incredibly rural. So, you know, I was surrounded by a forest and then a cornfield. So I could not only see lots and lots of stars, but also in the distance, you could see the lights from Louisville, Kentucky. And so from a very young age, I kind of learned what light pollution was and how much of a challenge light pollution is. And, you know, you have all of these street lights that light up the night sky so much that it's just difficult to see anything. So I kind of grew up being aware of those issues and really valuing my time looking at the stars and having that chance, really.
Mm. But eventually, of course, you did decide to come to the UK. What is it that made you do that?
So I think one of the unique things about science and about astronomy is how international it is. So really, you have people from all around the world. It doesn't matter your background, where you're from. Those things don't really matter. You're all coming together to ask questions and to figure out more about our natural world and about the universe. So I think that really drew me. So when I was looking at becoming a scientist and doing a PhD in order to do my own research and be a scientist, I really wanted to take advantage of how international science is. And so that's when I decided to actually come to the UK in order to pursue my scientific career and so to do my PhD.
Hmm. So you actually went to university still in the United States of America then. So where did you go and what was it that you actually studied?
So when I first went to university, I actually didn't study astronomy. I ended up studying physics. And so I got my undergraduate degree from Loyola University in New Orleans, Louisiana. And I studied physics and maths while I was there. But I became kind of more and more interested in astronomy after working during the summer at the University of Chicago, where I had a 6-week project involving quasars, so these kind of distant galaxies that have active black holes in their very center. And so you have material falling into these black holes, and the black holes are emitting radiation, and it makes them very, very bright. We can see them with telescopes. And so it was after that summer that I spent in Chicago that I decided that I really wanted to pursue astronomy. Now, after my undergraduate degree, I ended up setting a year out and kind of thinking about what I wanted to do and what I wanted to study. I knew I wanted to pursue science, but I wasn't quite sure what area to pursue. So in that year that I sat out, I ended up working as a scientist at the Fermi National Accelerator Laboratory outside of Chicago, Illinois. And then that's when I decided to pursue my PhD. And so I moved over to the UK and I did a PhD in physics, specializing in astrophysics from the University of Exeter in England.
So your PhD research, was it connected to the short research that you've done over the summer, or was it something entirely different?
So I ended up doing something completely different. What I knew from that summer doing research is that I really wanted to work with telescopes. So I knew that there was different types of astrophysics you could do. You know, some people use maths, so they do theoretical astrophysics. And some people do lots of computer simulations. And so they do computational astrophysics. I wanted to use a telescope to look at space. So I pursued observational astrophysics. And the University of Exeter, they allowed me to use near-infrared and radio telescopes. So these are telescopes that can see light that our eyes can't see. So they're outside of the visible wavelengths of light. And so there I ended up using those telescopes to study star and kind of going into planet formation. But really what I wanted to understand were how stars formed. So I used telescopes literally to take pictures of baby stars in our galaxy.
And you say you wanted to move away from sort of, or didn't particularly want to do sort of the computational astronomy and that sort of thing, but as observational astronomy goes, radio is pretty complex.
Yeah, so I think with most astronomy and astrophysics, you can never get away from a computer. So you have to know how to code in different computer languages in order to take that data, so take these pictures of space and kind of turn it into something that makes sense. So something that we can really use in science to understand what space is really like. So yes, even though I didn't want to run the simulations themselves, I still had to use lots and lots of computer coding to do that work, absolutely.
So what sort of things did you actually find out during your research? What were you discovering?
So really what I was doing was, I was trying to better understand when a star first forms. So essentially what's happening is you have lots and lots of gas and dust in space, and it almost forms into clouds, but not clouds like what we have here on the Earth. These are kind of beautiful rainbow-colored clouds in space. It's pretty strange. And eventually these clouds kind of collapse in on itself in order to form stars, so these baby stars that we call protostars. And what I was interested in was when these stars first form, they actually, it's almost like they go through a terrible twos phase, or like they're toddlers and they're throwing tantrums and things. So you have these massive outflows that extend from the stars. And what I was actually trying to understand is if these outflows could actually disrupt the clouds so much that it ends all star formation in these regions of space. So that's what I was studying, and in general I found that the outflows weren't really powerful enough to stop star formation, which is, you know, it's pretty good for the future of star formation in those regions of space.
Yeah, if you do have a couple of stars forming and they say no more, that would be unfortunate for that cluster of stars.
Yeah, exactly. So, but over time, and after my PhD, because I continued to work for research for several years, I ended up moving from star formation into planet formation, because forming a star actually kickstarts the process of forming planets, because planets will start to form around a star. So I then kind of segued into that and started asking questions about, you know, how do planets first start to form? How do rocky planets form? Just like, you know, the Earth or Mercury, Venus, and Mars in our own solar system. And how does dust stick together to actually form into these massive rocky planets? Because to form a rocky planet, you actually have to start small with these tiny dust grains in space. So I ended up kind of moving more into answering, trying to answer those questions.
Mm-hmm. But at some point you decided to shift into science communication, hence why you ended up here. So what is it that made you make that move from research, from academia, into science communication?
So I think, you know, I did really enjoy trying to answer important questions about space and really, you know, try to uncover those things that we still don't know about space. But I think what made me switch into science communication is that when I was a researcher, I didn't always have the opportunity to talk to people about what I was doing. And I think that's a really important thing. It's important that we're finding more things out about space and we're really understanding the universe around us. But, you know, I also think it's as equally important to talk to people about those discoveries and to talk to people at the level that they can understand those discoveries, because we're talking about incredibly technical things here. You know, we have massive telescopes and massive computers that have to do these calculations in order to make these discoveries. And it just seems like such a shame that people wouldn't widely know about all of the amazing things that we're finding out about. So that's why I ended up moving into science communication, because I wanted to kind of change focus to make sure people were aware of all of these amazing discoveries in our amazing universe.
And you started that quite early. You started that even while you were still doing research as a postdoc in, where was it you were doing the research at the time?
At Imperial College London.
Yeah.
So I started working with the Royal Observatory then, and I was talking to mainly secondary school students about my research, but also about, you know, just what's going on in science and how they can pursue a career in science if that's something that they're interested in. And then I started kind of moving into talking to the public as well by doing planetarium shows at the Royal Observatory. So even then, I felt like it was incredibly important to tell people about what was going on and all of the great things that we were finding.
Hmm. And a few years later, you became a full-time member of staff here as part of the public team. And then almost exactly 1 year ago, you actually got pushed up to the senior manager position.
Yeah.
So happy anniversary on that.
Thank you.
What is your role here? What do you actually do on a day-to-day basis?
So currently, I'm the senior manager of public astronomy at the Royal Observatory. So what that means is that all of the public events that we do at the observatory that is related to astronomy. So that can be anything from science fiction nights to lectures and talks at the Royal Observatory to the astronomy courses that we run to planetarium shows and community programs. So for example, we have an astronomy and Islam program. So any of those public events, I manage under a team of astronomers and science communicators in the public astronomy team.
And as part of that, what's actually your favourite part of your role here?
So I think I do really enjoy kind of planning the public program over the year. I think that's really fun. It's really nice to see kind of connections between the program and making sure that we're really just keeping up to date with astronomy and, you know, communicating that to people. One of my favorite parts, I don't have a chance to do very much anymore, but really it's just talking to people. You know, that's what got me interested in science communication. And that's still what keeps me in science communication, is just being able to talk to people and connect them about astronomy. I think this is really important because astronomy is one of those sciences that is incredibly accessible. It's probably the most accessible science. You don't need technical equipment to do it. And I'm pretty sure everyone's walked out at night at some point in their lives and looked up and seen stars, they've seen the moon, they've noticed that the moon is changing, and people will notice the sun, of course, during the day. So I think being able to bring out that awe and wonder of the universe is just so incredibly important, and share that with people. So yeah, my favorite part really is just talking to people one-on-one about astronomy and how amazing it is.
Now, while you've been here, you've actually still been involved in research, and in fact, in one particularly exciting discovery some months ago, all about Venus. What was all that about?
So, yeah, so this is something that caught me by surprise, actually. So I did try to stay up to date with research a bit once I moved into science communication and astronomy communication. And before I left research, I'd been involved in a study about Venus. Specifically about how different gases can be used to search for life on planets. And so my past work in planet formation ended up kind of getting me involved in this study. So previously I'd used gases to try to answer questions about stars and about planets forming very far away from us. But in this study, we were trying to use radio telescopes to search for gases that could indicate life on the planet Venus. And so what that study was really about was we were looking for a specific gas called phosphine in Venus's atmosphere. And this is a bit of a weird and wonderful gas, because on the Earth, this gas directly is created by life. The type of life that we're talking about are microbes or microorganisms. So we find these microorganisms inside the guts of animals. And it just so happens that they produce this phosphine gas. So for example, if you look at penguins in Antarctica, penguins actually have these little microbes that produce phosphine gas. And you can actually find a strong correlation in Antarctica between penguin poo and phosphine gas. And it's just because the microbes produce this gas in the guts of penguins.
I seem to remember you saying that your supervisor at the time introduced you to this topic via that.
Yeah, exactly. So, I mean, this is one of the things. So it was from one of these studies that my boss at Cardiff University, Professor Jane Greaves, actually, it was from that study that she got this idea to look for phosphine gas on Venus. And so she walked into my office one day and just said, do you want to study penguin poop in Venus's atmosphere? And I mean, what better response? You just say yes, absolutely.
Of course you do.
You don't ask questions, you just do it. But this is, so this gas seems to be unique anyway. On a rocky planet like the Earth, the gas is produced by life. We do find it in other places in our solar system, and it's not produced by life. Hmm. So on a gas planet like Jupiter or Saturn, phosphine gas can be produced through natural chemistry. So you get high enough temperatures and high enough pressures in these massive gas planets, you can also make phosphine gas. But on a rocky planet, it's just a lot more difficult for it to be produced. So that's one of the reasons why we wanted to look for this gas. It shouldn't technically be on a planet like Venus, because there aren't high enough temperatures and pressures on this planet to produce it. So it was kind of, it was just a fun study that we put together to try to search for this gas. And by the time I left research, I'd not really heard of any results coming from this study. And until I got an email about a year after I had moved into science communication at the Royal Observatory, and I was told that actually we found phosphine gas on this planet in the atmosphere. And that led to, we needed chemists to run models to try to figure out where the phosphine was coming from and how it was produced. We still can't quite explain it, which could mean that there is some sort of life in Venus's atmosphere actually producing phosphine gas, just like what we see on the Earth. So that's an incredibly exciting study that I was really happy to be a part of, and really unexpected as well.
And who knows, one day we may discover that that was our first positive detection of something produced by life on another world. Who knows?
Absolutely. It's a possibility. I mean, I think in the future, what we're really going to need is a spacecraft to go out to Venus and to scoop up the atmosphere and study it directly, really. Mm. So that's how maybe one day we'll be able to confirm that there is life in Venus's atmosphere.
Okay, then. So if you weren't doing science communication, and perhaps if you weren't a researcher either, what would you be doing instead?
Professional zombie hunter as well.
Very good. Excellent. Yes. There's a lot of call for those.
I missed a calling.
Yes.
Yeah. In all seriousness, I think I would have moved into engineering. Hmm. And it's just because I really like building things and kind of seeing how things work. And any time I would observe on a telescope, I was always really fascinated by how telescopes work and how they're put together. And so I think engineering is something that still really fascinates me. And I think that's what I would have ended up pursuing instead of astronomy.
And lastly, do you have any advice for a budding astronomer or science communicator, someone who's looking to get into one of those roles?
So I think the most important thing people can do if they're interested in astronomy or science is to stay curious and to keep asking questions. you know, there are no stupid questions. And by asking questions, that's how you learn. And that's how everyone learns, really. And there will come a day when you ask a question that no one can answer. And that is a really exciting feeling. No one can answer your question. So at that point, that's when you can do your own research and try to answer it yourself. So I would say definitely stay curious. And also keep looking up. You know, like I said before, astronomy is incredibly accessible. You don't need lots of equipment to do it. So just look up at the sky at night, learn your constellations, find out, you know, you can look up when planets are going to be in the sky. There's actually 5 planets you can see without a telescope. You know, you can just use your eyes to see them. So take a look at your night sky and keep asking those questions, really.
Thanks, Emily, for joining us today. We'll have more interviews with the rest of our astronomers coming up on our YouTube channel very soon.